98.1 FM and AM 1220.
Welcome to Aging with Power. The following is paid programming and does not necessarily reflect the opinions of KHTS or its ownership.
Santa Clarita, and welcome to Aging with Power, sponsored by Comfort Keepers and Home Care. I am your host, Myles McNamara, and our show focuses on the challenges and the topics that we face on this journey that we call aging. We begin aging from the moment we take our first breath, and although our show will primarily focus on adult and senior issues, we will from time to time visit areas of the entire aging spectrum, from the womb to the tomb. Our subject matter experts will address concerns and questions that will empower us all to make informed decisions. If you ever have a question during our show, we are interactive. We're actually live on Facebook, so just search for at KHTS Radio. Or you can even call in at 661-298-5487, 661-298-KHTS, and hit us with your questions. We'd love to address your concerns because preparation is knowledge. And knowledge is power. Today we are going to be talking about colon cancer, colorectal cancer. You may or may not know that March is Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month, so we're going to unpack that. And I am happy to have in studio today two amazing guests, Dr. Danny Issa and Dr. Michael Quon, both gastroenterologists with UCLA Health. And gentlemen, I know you're busy. Thank you for taking the time to come out today.
Thank you for having us.
Awesome. And we're going to get into a lot today, so please stay tuned. Before we do, though, I'd like to make a couple announcements. Coming up in April, it's kind of down the road, but, you know, it's only next month. Put it on your save the date. Mental illness is something that we all deal with, probably if not ourselves. We know and love someone who does. It's a stigma that we need to address. But we're having our second Out of the Darkness walk at COC on Saturday, April 25th. It brings awareness and prevention to suicide, mental illness, etc. So if you'd like to be involved in that, Comfort Keepers is proud to be the presenting sponsor for that this year. Go to afsp.org/Santa Clarita. AFSP is American Foundation of Suicide Prevention.org/Santa Clarita. Form a team. There's sponsorships available, etc., etc. It's Saturday, April 25th. It's 9 a.m. Registration starts at 8. We do our walk. We're out by noon, so it's a quick hit. We raise money for mental illness and suicide awareness and prevention. So again, that's afsp.org/Santa Clarita. You can get your company out there as a sponsor, and you can form a team, and we do the walk. We raise important funds and awareness, so please do so. We'd love to have you. And also, before we hit the first commercial break here, I don't usually get political on this show, but I did want to kind of let you understand something that's on the ballot today. Today is voting day, and something that is masked that you may not be aware of, as they a lot of times do, like they did last time with our state gas measure. Measure 13 is masked to look like it's helping schools and preschools and K-12s, and what they do not mention once in this measure, that it will roll back a lot of the Prop 13 protections for commercial properties. I know with the politicians and our news media, they try to perpetuate class wars and keep everybody at each other's throat. And, you know, business owners, property owners, a lot of time demonize, what have you. But folks, this is the trickle down theory. If they roll back the Prop 13 protection of commercial properties and basically doubles the expense of goods and services that are provided to people who are having their rents raised because of these raised property taxes, property owners who will have to raise their prices to pay said new double in taxes. So read through this. I think it's almost unlawful itself to not tell you where the money's coming from, but masked in this little bill that says it's going to help schools, it's really going to hurt businesses, it's going to hurt property owners, and that will trickle down to you. So if you're going to get out and vote today, take a second look at State Measure 13. I would urge a vote no. That's just my take. So we're going to take our first commercial break. You are listening to Aging with Power on your hometown station, AM 1220, KHTS, and 98.1 FM.
Comfort Keepers provide your loved one with loving in-home care.
Myles McNamara, certified senior advisor and owner of Comfort Keepers in-home care.
Our caregivers can help you in your own home, enhancing independence, creating safety and comfort. Our Comfort Keepers provide companionship, meal preparation, medication reminders, assistance with personal care, and even transportation to doctor's appointments. If someone you love can use a helping hand at home, visit ComfortKeepers.com.
Or call 287-4200.
A 14th-generation patriot and second-generation Marine, Kenneth Jinks has led from the front, building telecommunications for school districts, municipalities, healthcare, and businesses for 35 years. Not an outsider. He's a 30-year resident of Santa Clarita, father and grandfather committed to the health and prosperity of our community. Kenneth is ready to charge Capitol Hill with leadership, halt sanctuary cities, put socialism in full retreat, and defend our sovereignty. If you support the Constitution and unalienable God-given rights, vote Kenneth Jinks for Congressman. KennethJinksForCongress.com. Paid for by the committee to elect Kenneth Jinks to Congress.
It's never been so easy to have a great night out. Whether it's a date night or girls' night out, experience Pinot's Palette in Valencia or Encino. Order your favorite drink from the bar and paint your very own masterpiece. No art experience needed. Local artists make it easy for you. So you can paint, sip, and listen to great music while creating a one-of-a-kind masterpiece. Fun, relaxing, and memorable. Pinot's Palette. To book your party, go to Pinot'sPalette.com. That's Pinot'sPalette.com.
Welcome back, folks. You're listening to Aging with Power on your hometown station, AM 1220 and 98.1 FM, KHTS. I'm Myles McNamara, and today we're also live on Facebook, so go to at KHTS Radio and give us a search, and you can shoot us a question, be involved as, you know, getting informed about today's topic, which is colorectal cancer. March, as I mentioned at the top of the show, is Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month. Two experts in-house with me today, Dr. Issa and Dr. Quon of UCLA Health. Again, gentlemen, welcome to Aging with Power.
Thank you. Thank you.
So let's start off with Dr. Issa and Dr. Quon. Tell us a little bit about yourself, your journey, and what has brought you to this level and with UCLA Health. Dr. Issa, go ahead and start us off.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having us. I'm an interventional gastroenterologist. I recently joined UCLA, moving from New York, where I did my interventional endoscopy training at Weill Cornell. I specialize in performing minimally invasive procedures to take care of complex gastrointestinal diseases, which certainly includes early colon cancer and large colon polyps. And by doing that, you're able to get patients, to the right path with minimally invasive approach without the need for major surgery sometimes.
No, the word interventional just means you do something about it, right? No,
yes.
On whatever level you – is there a non-interventional gastroenterologist?
Yes, so I think sometimes we practice general gastroenterology, which also includes doing endoscopy, which includes colonoscopy, that we will talk about today. But when you have something that's a little bit more complex, large tumor in the colon or large polyp or early cancer, and you require a little bit more invasive, still minimally invasive interventions, so that's a subspecialty that we refer to as interventional endoscopy or interventional gastroenterology.
Gotcha. And Dr. Quon.
Hi. I'm Dr. Quon. I'm very local. I was born and raised in Los Angeles. I went to USC undergrad and ended up at USC Medical School. I trained at County for a long time, and I'm a gastroenterologist. I was in private practice for approximately 22 years. Then I joined UCLA as of 2014. So I'm a Trojan at heart, but UCLA Health is probably the one of the best integrated healthcare systems in the country.
Probably take a lot of heat for that at your alumni meetings, huh?
I definitely do.
Well, why don't we start off? I mean, again, I think colorectal cancer is such an issue that it deserves more than a month, but it is awareness month for said disease. Why don't we start off with breaking down the word colorectal and kind of giving an overview of what colon cancer is? And again, I like to keep this very informal. It's like we're sitting around the coffee table just, chatting. So just jump in and however we want to discuss this hugely important topic.
So colon cancer is very common in this country. It's, if you combine men and women, it's number two killer in cancer. So And it's a very preventable disease. So at the age of 50, we all should get a colonoscopy. Unless you're higher risk, such as African American, you should get a colonoscopy at the age of 45 or some sort of family history. So usually at average risk is 50 years old, you should start getting a colonoscopy, start getting screened.
That bears repeating. It's the second leading cause of death of cancer-related issues in the country. And what's number one?
Number one is probably lung.
Lung?
Right.
Wow. Number
Followed
two.
Followed by breasts in ladies and probably prostate in men.
Okay. And the thing about, as actually we always hear the term early detection, I mean, as with anything, very treatable if caught very early, yes?
That's correct. So we divide cancers into stages. Stage one and two are considered early stages. So for stage one, for example, survival for 5 years, meaning how many people will be alive after 5 years, is over 90%. So that's pretty good. So if you detect the cancer early on, we have really great options, and it's potentially curable, meaning that we can get complete remission, and then you're not going to die from this cancer.
And define for me, if you would, colon cancer. I mean, it's not like the deterioration of the entire colon. It's tumors and growths inside of an otherwise healthy colon?
Absolutely. Colon is the last part of your GI or digestive tract. And as you mentioned, rectum is the very last part of the colon. So it's around it's around 10 centimeters long, the rectum itself. The colon is 5 to 6 feet long. So basically, when you have a growth, you know, inside the colon, abnormal growth, and some cells start just going, you know, crazy and just, you know, develop, you know, just, you know, growing more and more to create this tumor. And that's what we call cancer. That's what we call tumor or malignant cancer. So basically, it's most likely a mass inside the colon. Certainly can be small, can grow if it's not detected early, and it can create some more symptoms, more trouble in the, if it grows to a certain size.
And I know we're going to get into some of the causes and some of the preventions and some of the awareness steps that we can take. I've heard a lot that cancer is caused by bad life choices, diets, what have you, but also that cancer is genetic, that folks are just kind of destined to have. Is that true, or is that more? Let's talk about that myth. It's not a myth.
There is a big genetic component to colon cancer, especially first degree relatives having colon cancer, especially if they are less than 6 years old, then you're at higher risk for colon cancer. And as I mentioned before, definitely African Americans at the age of 45 have a higher risk for colon cancer. So we screen them a lot earlier than other groups of people.
Because I've seen, unfortunately, I mean, you've seen folks that, you know, it just runs in the family, whether it be breast, prostate, you know, it's just like, it seems like cancer is so dominant in that family that it's almost like a gene that's more active. I mean, I'm trying to get my head around why folks just get cancer because their mom had cancer.
Well, there's certain syndromes, something called Lynch syndrome, where women can have breast cancer, uterine cancer, and where the men can get colon cancer. So there are family syndromes of colon cancer, along with other types of cancers.
All right, well, we're going to take our next break, and when we come back, we're going to kind of, like I said, unpack of the different things that we can be aware of in not only early detection, but prevention and treatment, et cetera, et cetera. So don't go away. You are listening to Aging with Power on your hometown station, AM 1220 and 98.1 KHTS.
Today is Election Day. It's Aaron Dalatori, making sure you get out and vote. For polling info, if you want to just check out election results, you can do so at hometownstation.com. Also, follow along with us across all of our social feeds at KHTS Radio.
Healthcare can be difficult if you're underinsured or have Medi-Cal. Samuel Dixon Family Health Center can help. Services are available on a sliding fee schedule. The mission of the Samuel Dixon Family Health Center is to give the Santa Clarita Valley access to affordable, quality primary care. There are three locations to serve you: Canyon Country, Newhall, and Valverde. Go to sdfhc.org for more information and to find the location most convenient for you.
Hi, this is Wendy Hassenflug, yoga and wellness entrepreneur. I'm excited to share one of the best-kept secrets in Santa Clarita. Top Out Climbing Gym is one of my favorite places. Rock climbing is exceptional for building upper and lower body strength, and it improves your flexibility. Almost anyone can rock climb, and you don't have to be super fit to climb. You'll build strength and stamina while having fun at the same time. Get over to Top Out Climbing Gym in Center Point and challenge yourself to new heights.
Welcome back, folks. You are listening to Aging with Power on your hometown station, AM 1220 and 98.1 FM KHTS. We have in-house today Dr. Quon and Dr. Issa, gastroenterologist, GI doctors. With March being Colorectal Cancer Awareness Month, we're peeling back that onion, and we're talking about a lot of different aspects that we need to be aware of. So, guys, we've sort of defined what colorectal cancer is and its prevalence and the second leading cause of death among cancer patients. So let's get into some of the other aspects of prevention, detection, treatment, you know, all these different things that we should be aware of.
Yeah, so it's very important to know that, but, you know, screening is available to look for early colon cancer, and detect it early and even treat it early. So that's why we take the chance this month to make sure people are aware that we have multiple options for screening in the year of 2020. And this includes colonoscopy, which is a very well-known method of screening, but it also includes what we call non-invasive ways of screening. And non-invasive meaning there's no, you know, scope or tube, going into the rectum or anything like that. So basically what we offer, what we can, discuss with the patients most of the times is doing a stool test that checks or detects blood in the stool. So two main methods for screening are available for patients, colonoscopy and blood and stool tests, which detects for blood. And that's what we call the most, the one that we use most of the time and promote based on research and data is called FIT testing, F-I-T. And that stands for fecal immunochemical testing. And this test detects, invisible blood in your stool. And that's kind of an indication that there might be something in the colon. And the next step is to do a colonoscopy.
Well, from a layman's point of view, if you're already having blood in your stool, might that be a little far along in the process? I mean,
might be. So having blood in stool is never normal. So that's something, you need to talk to your doctor about, and you might need a colonoscopy about it. So you'll need to talk about medications, diet, and other things. But you might need further. You certainly need further, visit to your doctor, and maybe more testing might not need, colonoscopy. But when we talk about screening, we mainly talk about asymptomatic patients. Asymptomatic meaning people who don't have any symptoms when they reach their age of 50 or 45. At some circumstances, that's when we start screening them.
It's something I might suggest as someone who's had a few colonoscopies in his life. don't take your stool sample after a hard stool, because if you have a little blood in your stool because it came out and maybe ruptured one of your little veins there coming out, that's what happened. I'm not going to get that personal, but if there's blood in the stool, it could have been just because you ruptured a vein while going to the restroom, correct?
Definitely. So hemorrhoids are very common. However, you don't want to miss that slight chance that you may have a polyp or even a tumor. So we take all bleeding seriously,
right?
Especially people that are 50 years or older. Because when you're 50, you're considered what's called average risk for colon cancer. So, but if you have symptoms such as bleeding, weight loss, change in bowel habits, those are the signs that you're looking for, and no longer it becomes a screening test that you need, but more of a diagnostic test to find out what the bleeding is from. So if you get a colonoscopy and you have hemorrhoids, be thankful, because
right,
it's not anything more serious.
Right. It's funny, I was joking with my staff the other day. I don't know if you know who Jim Gaffigan is, one of my favorite comedians. He does this whole routine on colonoscopies, and he says the best news you can get from your doctor when they stick a camera up your hiney is that they didn't have to stick a camera up your hiney. so that's always the good news. But let's roll it back a little bit, because what's the earliest documented, and for other reasons that are abnormal, of course, but what's the earliest diagnosis of colon cancer that you've seen in a patient? How young?
So Dr. Quon has long experience, and he can also talk about this. We've seen cancers at 20 years old. If you have family history, strong family history of syndromes of colon cancer, something like Lynch syndrome or FAP, you might start developing cancers at even earlier stage. But you know, just not to confuse, you know, our the people and our audience, you usually know about those syndromes, those uncommon syndromes. For the average risk individuals, I think the average age for colon cancer to be detected is around 62, 63. So if you're at average risk, no family history, 62, 63 is the average risk to be detected. But we have certainly seen cancer starts at earlier ages.
And go ahead, Dr. Quon.
I've seen a physician, 35 years old, with colon cancer. So he comes to me, he says, "Hey, Mike, I've had bleeding for a while. I'm pretty sure it's hemorrhoids." And I said, "Listen, let's do a colonoscopy just to be on the safe side." So he ended up having colon cancer.
Wow.
This well-educated doctor, he ends up getting colon cancer because he kind of ignored his rectal bleeding.
And that's the thing. We all think we're immortal, like I was talking about at the break. Like, it'll never happen to us. So you ignore certain things because you don't want to go in and get the bad news. The new news is good news, so you don't do anything about it. I guess my question from all this was because of – is there anything wrong, or do insurances snub you if just for shiggles that because of, you know, terrible diets of this age and whatever, is there anything wrong with someone 25, 30 years old just saying, you know what, I want a bench line, I want a benchmark, I want to go in, I want to get a colonoscopy just to clear the air, and then I'll hit the road with my regular, you know, exams down the road. There's nothing wrong with that, right? I mean, erring on the side of caution?
They won't cover. So when Obamacare came about in 2010, it allowed everyone that's 50 years or older to get covered for colon cancer. So you don't even have to pay a copay or any deductible. You straight out get covered for a colonoscopy. So, however, anybody that's under 50 years old, unless they have symptoms like rectal bleeding, change in bowel habits, then that would allow you to get a colonoscopy, but it no longer is a screening colonoscopy. It's more of a diagnostic colonoscopy.
Right. And, of course, where does family genealogy come in? What if you come in at 25, 30 years old and you say, you know, all my guys in my family has had colon cancer? Will the insurance then give you the nod?
They will.
They will?
They will. Right.
Yeah, they should. And we can, you know, we're always happy to talk and push and try to help our patients to get what is right and appropriate for them. Family history is extremely important. It's good to remind, you know, patients to look into their family trees, ask about those things, and talk to their primary care doctors, family doctors, so we can tell them, you know what, you might need to start your screening at an earlier stage than the average, you know, risk person or your friends or something like that.
Yeah, I mean, I've been doing this kind of stuff for a long time, and I didn't realize it ranks so high as number two. I mean, that's some scary stuff. And so we're going to take our next break, and when we come back, let's start again diving into, you know, diet, some of the fad diets, some of the preventable things that, you know, we can do as intelligent adults to take care of our bodies and keep these types of things in mind. So let's do that. We'll be back in a hop, skip, and a jump, folks. You are listening to Aging with Power on your hometown station, 1220 AM and 98.1 FM KHTS.
At Eyelid Agua Dulce, we believe the most important thing a child can learn in school is who they are. Life's real tests are never standardized, which is why we've developed an individual-based curriculum that values exploration, cooperation, and creativity. As our learners grow, so do we. Our tuition-free charter school is currently enrolling grades TK through 7th and adding 8th grade in 2020. Your young learner will be immersed in a unique environment where possibility and self-discovery are at the core of every experience. The Agua Dulce campus features beautiful indoor and outdoor spaces for hands-on inspiration, including a robotics lab, a garden bed, a greenhouse, and a technology-based exploratorium. Eyelid Agua Dulce is conveniently located on the east side of the Santa Clarita Valley, just off the 14 freeway. Check out our homeschool options, too. To schedule a campus tour or learn more about our programs, visit eyelidaguadulce.org. We're enrolling now. Eyelid Schools. Free to think. Inspired to lead.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. We salute our veterans who sacrificed for our freedom.
Santa Clarita veteran, Bill Reynolds.
Each week, we share an inspirational story of a local veteran on our Hometown Heroes page at hometownstation.com, thanks to our good friends at Eternal Valley.
I'm Richard Nunnally, General Manager of Eternal Valley Memorial Park and Mortuary. We believe taking care of each other is what community is all about. We're proud to bring you the stories of our hometown heroes.
Eternal Valley, life well celebrated.
Welcome back, folks. You are listening to Aging with Power on your hometown station, AM 1220 and 98.1 FM KHTS. Don't forget, we are live on Facebook. Go to at KHTS Radio and give us a shout if you have a question. We are talking colorectal cancer today. Two experts in-house, Dr. Issa and Dr. Quon from UCLA Health. We're talking about not only is March Awareness Month, but we're talking about screenings. We're talking about prevention. We're talking about symptoms. We're talking all things colorectal cancer. Something you can't stick your head in the sand about, folks. It's the number two cause of death among cancer patients in the U.S. So that's quite a stat. So doctors are in the house, and we've talked about some screenings. We've talked about some symptoms. Now let's roll back and say, well, let's be a little aware and do some preventable things in our life that keeps our GI system strong, healthy, and wise.
Yeah, we were talking about risk factors for colon cancer, so we really touched heavily on genetics, but there's other things that are risk factors also. Physical inactivity, obesity, a poor diet such as a diet that's low in fiber and high in animal fat. Other risk factors include diabetes, alcohol. Those are pretty much the risk factors, and in addition, smoking is a risk factor for colon cancer.
You guys probably pull your hair out with all these silly fad diets you see, that people are completely omitting certain aspects of a balanced diet out of their life because of something they read on the internet. I mean, what have you seen as physicians as far as the adverse conditions to people when they're doing all these fad diets to lose a few pounds, but they're just destroying their diet?
Yeah, so you're right. As we were talking earlier, there are multiple diets that that come out every year. It's like almost 100 new books on diets every year comes out on Amazon. So that tells you that no one diet is absolutely good for everyone. Otherwise, you'd not have 100 diets coming out. But some diets are very popular nowadays. So if we're drifting into weight loss because obesity and being overweight is certainly an associated with increased risk of colon cancer and multiple other cancers. So there are a couple diets that are out there now. We know they're good as of the data we have right now. One of them is low calories, low carb diet, some high fat diet, sometimes called keto diet, very popular nowadays.
Right.
And there is a new way of dieting that's called intermittent fasting. And basically it can be done in a variety of ways, basically what you do is you fast for 16 hours and then you eat one meal and then you fast again for like 4 hours or so, and then you eat another meal. So you give your body long, hours of fasting, and let your metabolism, get dependent on ketone, ketone bodies, which is not sugar, and that in that way you help your body to, digest the fat and you lose weight. So those are the two popular diets in this, currently this year. But again, as you mentioned, there are a lot of diets. There are a lot of different things people can follow. To get back to colon cancer, I think there are two main things that we need to focus on. As Dr. Quon said, alcohol consumption is really associated, especially heavy alcohol consumption associated with increased risk of colon cancer. Smoking is a diet that is low in fiber is good for the colon. So that is proven actually to show decrease in the risk of colon cancer.
Low in fiber?
The high fiber diet. High fiber diet decrease. A high fiber diet is good for colon, yeah.
And then what about the intermittent fasting? Because if I went 16 hours without eating, I would eat the kitchen table when it's my time to eat. So I'm assuming that when you come off that 16-hour fast, you still have to be somewhat, don't eat four portions, or does it matter? Is it one of those type of diets, if you do that sort of interval intermittent fasting, that you could have two double doubles and be good if you do the whole fasting thing, or is there a whole kind of combination calculation to that?
That's an excellent question, and I think there are different ways to do it, and that's why it's not the best diet for everybody. Some people really do well on this diet. So I would say, you know, the first meal you break your fast with is the first meal you eat. You know, we call it breakfast normally. It's the meal right. that you break your fast with. It's okay to be a fully balanced meal, including including protein, fat, and carbohydrates. So it's good for this meal to be a really well balanced meal. So you can certainly have a good meal. You can have around 1,500 calories or like 1,200 calories in that specific meal, but you don't want to exceed way too much. And what I've seen from people, once you start doing this, after a few days to a couple weeks, your body gets used to it. So you're really not that hungry, because you pass that point where you're really feeling so hungry, and you get to the point that you're kind of balanced, but you need to feed yourself. You need some food. So when you get used to it, it becomes more and more easily to do and more doable.
And I don't mean to be disrespectful to folks that are challenged with their weight, but I try to look at it, because it's not rocket science in that we talk about doing things in moderation. Well, it's sort of the same with diets. If you look at moderation, keep an eye on your calories, keep an eye on your carbs, keep an eye on your sugars, keep an eye on, so if you really, a lot of times folks say, I'm on the keto diet, and they're eating 7,000 calories a day. Well, you're still going to gain weight, because it's a mathematical formula. So, I think when we look at diets and of course activity, I see folks trying to lose weight and they're not doing a lick of exercise. Think how much easier it would be if you just did a lap, burn a few calories off. So it really is moderation that you guys probably struggle with day to day, just trying to get that through people's head, right?
I agree totally. If you look at the African population, there's no colon cancer. There's no screening for colon cancer. And you look at those people, they're very thin. Their diet is very, very well proportioned. And they don't eat the high animal fat diet. They don't eat the low fiber. It's very high in fiber. So,
and you don't see an obesity issue.
You don't see obesity. And there's no risk for colon cancer.
No risk for colon cancer. I mean, if you can just highlight the reasons there, it seems pretty easy to transfer over here, no?
Right. Yes. Yeah, so, we, being overweight certainly is a very, very, very common problem. And it's not only in the United States, it's worldwide. And we know approximately 30% of the adult population in the United States are overweight. Now, it's one risk factor for colon cancer. We don't want to ignore the other ones, but it's an important one for colon cancer and other cancers. So just think about it, 30% of people are overweight, and 17% of children nowadays are overweight. The good news is we have options, and we're all available for patients to come if they have difficulty wrapping their head around what diet to do, what exercise to follow, what procedures they need. So we're all available to discuss the options, to refer them to the right referral, right physician, right surgeon, nutritionist, and we have multiple options to offer to get them to that, hopefully to help them lose weight and maintain the loss.
Cool. Well, we're going to take our next break. When we come back, let's kind of segue into some of the myths around the risks of a colonoscopy and why folks shouldn't be so scared of said procedure. So we're going to talk about that when we get back, folks. You are listening to Aging with Power, excuse me, on your hometown station, 98.1 FM and AM 1220 KHTS.
Hi, this is Wendy Hassenflug, yoga and wellness entrepreneur. I'm excited to share one of the best-kept secrets in Santa Clarita. Top Out Climbing Gym is one of my favorite places. Rock climbing is exceptional for building upper and lower body strength, and it improves your flexibility. Almost anyone can rock climb, and you don't have to be super fit to climb. You'll build strength and stamina while having fun at the same time. Get over to Top Out Climbing Gym in Center Point and challenge yourself to new heights.
The Santa Clarita Valley Tigers are your hometown football team. We are more than football, we are community. We play football to raise awareness and funds for various charities within our community. We've contributed to Family Promise, breast cancer awareness, and we were there when Saugus needed us. To find out how you can help, check out our website at goscvtigers.com. That's goscvtigers.com. Santa Clarita Valley Tigers football. We're more than football, we're community.
Hey there, it's Tori with your hometown station weather. A nice day today. We're looking at sunny skies and highs in the upper 70s. Overnight lows in the upper 40s. More the same the rest of the week. For anything and everything Santa Clarita Valley related, go to hometownstation.com.
98.1 FM and AM 1220.
Welcome back, folks. You're listening to Aging with Power on your hometown station, AM 1220 and 98.1 FM KHTS. I'm still your host, Myles McNamara, and we are talking all things colorectal cancer today with UCLA Health, which we're going to give you some contact information at the end of the show. UCLA Health has an amazing footprint out here in Santa Clarita, and we're going to let you know how to be in contact with them should you want to be. To take advantage of some of their amazing doctors and services. But right now we hear a lot about colonoscopies. I know from personal experience, the prep is worse than the procedure. So we're going to talk a little bit about that procedure right now and why you shouldn't be scared of it and what are, if any, the risks associated with a colonoscopy. But let's lead off with that, either Dr. Issa or Dr. Quon, whichever would like to take this. We always hear about we're looking for polyps. If we do a colonoscopy and we see a polyp, is it cancerous? Is it benign? What the blue blazes is a polyp?
So polyp is an abnormal growth in the colon. So at the age of 50, when you're at average risk, you have about a 30% chance of having a polyp. For women, it's about 25% chance.
Not that it'll be cancer, just you got a little bit of a growth in your colon, right? Polyp isn't always bad news.
So a polyp, there's several types of polyp. One's precancerous, and the other one's usually inflammatory, an inflammatory polyp. So it's hard to tell when you're scoping somebody to see whether it's a precancer polyp or not, so we take all polyps out. So if you don't have any polyps, especially for men, you have a 70% chance of having nothing. So your next colonoscopy will be in 10 years.
And I don't know how common it is, but this is what got me on the track of young and ongoing colonoscopies. I don't know how prevalent this is, but maybe you can touch on it if it is more common, is diverticulosis, which leads to diverticulitis, which I got from my lovely grandma because I guess it was somewhat, hereditary. So when I was in my late 20s, early 30s, I was having tremendous, abdominal cramps and pains, and it turned out that I had diverticulosis, that if I didn't take care of it, would turn into diverticulitis. Do you see that a lot?
We see it a lot. It's very, very common. Most of the times it's asymptomatic, so we find it while we're doing colonoscopy.
And that's just a lot of polyps out of control, right?
Yeah. So it's diverticulosis, it's not polyps. It's different. So what happens is the wall of the colon at some areas becomes really weak, and the pockets start to form inside the colon, very small pockets. And those pockets is what we call diverticulosis. So it's literally just weakness points in the wall of the colon that kind of protrude out, per se, and forms what we call diverticulosis. So that's the general term. If they get inflamed, if you have inflammation, abdominal pain, fever, that's when you have diverticulitis. So the itis at the end of the word means you have inflammation. Not every diverticulosis will become diverticulitis. But the good thing to know is it's very common, and it's very benign. It's completely benign, does not turn into cancer. So it's not something that you have to worry that you're gonna get cancer from it or polyps from it or anything like that. It's separate, it's just a common finding that can give you some trouble sometimes, but it's not cancer.
But it's also reversible. Because unless that I was misinformed, because I had it in my, like I said, early 30s, they put me on, psyllium or psyllium or whatever, and I did that for, when I had my last one, they're like, it's gone. You don't have diverticulosis anymore. I'm like, cool.
Yeah, exactly. So from what we know, constipation is a risk factor for diverticulosis. So if you're not moving your bowels, once every 2 days, 3 days, you can start having those pockets in the colon. And also diet can, some studies show diet can contribute to this. So high fiber diet, helps with diverticulosis. So yes, you're right. If you move your bowel frequently, if you have a good bowel habits, you probably will be fine. Yeah.
Cool. Well, let's talk about risks. I mean, obviously whenever you put something into your body, there has to be some level of risk, but I think a lot of it's blown out of proportion. What are the risks associated with a colonoscopy?
So the risk for a colonoscopy is basically two. One's perforation and the other one's bleeding. But it's very low, like 1 in 1,000 cases. And usually those risks happen when we try to take out a polyp. I mean, sometimes he can bleed, or sometimes if we take out a polyp, we use a cautery, and that can burn through the colon wall and cause a perforation. But those risks are extremely small, very small.
And nothing fatal, correct? I mean, it seems like you could probably say, oops, let's fix this. I mean, have you seen any deaths?
So usually when there's a perforation now, we have tools to take care of that now. We have clips that we can usually clip in and close up the perforation. A lot of times we can admit the patient to the hospital, put them on antibiotics, and not do any surgery whatsoever.
Okay. But as I said earlier, kind of jokingly, it is kind of true that the prep is more of an issue than the procedure, yes?
That's true. So it's not the most tasteful thing to drink. So to make sure we can see well inside your colon, we want to make sure we cleanse your colon nicely from inside. So that's when we give our patients what we call prep. So it's basically a solution, a salty tasting solution, as you know. I've tasted it myself, and it's not very it's not greatly pleasant, but it's not terrible. All patients usually tolerate it just fine. But yes, it's you have to miss time from work, for the time of the procedure. You have to prep the day before. So those things are kind of inconvenience for patients.
Do some binge watching the day before.
Yes.
But again, the taste, rather, as you said, it's not pleasant. That's not what bothers. It's what that taste and the result of what you're doing does to you, because you might as well just take your book, your TV into the bathroom, because you're not going far that day.
You have to stay close, that's for sure.
Yeah, you definitely have to keep those walls clean so you guys can take a good picture.
Yeah.
There's actually several different types, actually many different preps that are out there. Yeah. The traditional prep is a gallon of solution. But there are other preps that are much smaller. The most popular prep right now out there is Miralax Gatorade. So who doesn't like Gatorade?
Right.
So you put some laxative Miralax, and it works almost just as well.
Oh, good to know, because I'm sure I have another one. But anyway, so the treatments. I mean, if someone does have a colonoscopy, you find a polyp, God forbid it's cancerous, what is the treatment that you guys see most prolific to deal with this type of diagnosis?
Yeah, so the good thing about doing colonoscopy is it's not only, screening, but if we find polyps, as we mentioned, we can take them out. And nowadays with the advances in interventional endoscopy or endoscopy in general, we're able to take out even, large polyps, as long as they are not cancer yet. If they become cancer, then the treatment will be, dependent on a few things. So what stage the cancer is, if it's early stage, as you said, it's relatively good news. Patients can get surgery and really get, curable results, get done with the cancer if it's in a very early stage. If it's an intermediate stage, we might have to do a couple things like chemotherapy, maybe surgery. If it's an advanced stage, we will refer the patients all the time. We will refer the patients to our oncologist, colleagues, and we will have a plan for them. So whether to go to surgery or to go to chemotherapy or radiation therapy, but no matter what, once we do this, once we get to that level, we really have a solid, strong system, and we know where to get the patient next. The patient is never alone, so we know you're gonna see this clinic next. We already put the referrals on the same day. We have groups of staff and nurse practitioners to help us arrange imaging, testing, and further investigations as needed. So the patient will be helped to go through the process if they found to have cancer.
And and removing a portion of the colon, is that fairly common, or is it strictly done with the treatment you just said?
It's possible if you have an early cancer and it's surgically managed, so meaning that we can safely remove that portion of the colon. Then a colorectal surgeon or a general surgeon will remove that portion of the colon and have what we call safe margins, so nothing on the edges of the removal, and that will usually take care of it.
I mean, I'm sure it's a different show. I'm just curious. I mean, there's so much darn colon in your gut that if you find a segment, rather than treating that tumor and all the, just cut that sucker out through the margins, reattach. I mean, they do that for, bypass surgery, don't they?
It is. It is the first line. Yeah, they do it for bypass, and it's the first line for early cancer. That's true. Surgery is the first line for
as
early
long
cancer.
As it doesn't metastasize but
exactly,
or spread.
Exactly. But we have to look at, get some imaging, probably CT scan and other things, make sure it's confined, it's only in that portion. Then, yes, surgery will be the next step for that. And as you said, the colon, you can live without a colon.
Right.
You can live without a colon, so you can get it out, and patients will be fine.
All right. Well, we're going to take our last break. When we come back, it's, again, folks, it's colorectal cancer awareness month. We're doing this so that you can be aware and maybe do a screening. So what if you want to get a screening? What should you do? Well, we're going to touch on that coming back, and we're going to bring into the mix Claudia Dunn Martinez. She's the marketing and community outreach for UCLA Health, and if that's your path, she's going to give you all you need to know about UCLA. I appreciate her efforts in bringing Dr. Quon and Dr. Issa on board today. So don't go away. We'll be back to wrap up this puppy. And you are still listening to Aging with Power on your hometown station, 98.1 FM and 1220 AM KHTS.
A health threat anywhere is a health threat everywhere. I'm Dr. Phil. A new coronavirus outbreak called COVID-19 started in China and is spreading to many countries, including the U.S. It's critical to get the facts about how to protect our friends and loved ones. While CDC is working with states and communities to stop the spread of the virus, health workers and emergency response efforts need our support. The CDC Foundation, a nonprofit organization, is focusing on immediate and critical needs that help protect our communities here at home and those around the world. We can all play a role in stopping this deadly virus. Get updates, learn how to protect your friends and family, and find out how to help. Go to cdcfoundation.org. That's cdcfoundation.org. Together, our impact is greater.
This has been a public service announcement brought to you by the CDC Foundation.
Today is Election Day. It's Aaron Dalatori, making sure you get out and vote. For polling info, if you want to just check out election results, you can do so at hometownstation.com. Also, follow along with us across all of our social feeds at KHTS Radio.
Welcome back, folks. This is Aging with Power on your hometown station, AM 1220 and 98.1 FM KHTS. We're wrapping up a very informative show today. March is Colorectal Awareness Month. If you've missed any part of this show, or if you'd like to refer it to someone who should listen, you can always re-listen on podcast. Just go to hometownstation.com. Go to the podcast section, go to Aging with Power, pick the show you want. All the shows we've ever done are there, but definitely push this one out there for us if you would. Screening is important. Dr. Quon, Dr. Issa, I so appreciate you taking time out of your busy schedule. Before we hand it off to Claudia to talk about, what do we do if we want to get screening, if you should get screening, any closing remarks that either of you would like to say regarding this important topic?
I know it's fearful to get a colonoscopy out there, but it's a simple test, and most of the people, after they're done with it, they can't believe how easy it was.
And it's not the first step. I mean, I'm sure Claudia will touch on this. I mean, you do a stool sample test see if there's any blood in your – that's not necessarily where you want to stop, though, right? Just because there's no blood in your stool doesn't necessarily mean you've got a don't have a polyp up there hiding.
No, so there's the two most popular tests is either the stool test or colonoscopy.
Okay.
But really the gold standard is really to get a colonoscopy.
Which I think is the best benchmark to do because, nothing, what do they say, a photo's worth 1,000 words? Let's go take a picture of that thing. How about you, Dr. Issa? Any closing remarks that you'd like to talk to about with our listeners?
Yes, absolutely. So, colon cancer, as we have talked about, it's the second leading cause of cancer-related death. But it really does not have to be, because good news is this cancer is preventable and treatable, especially if we detect it in early stages. Whether you like to do a test at home or whether you like to come see one of our experts and get a colonoscopy, our message to you is basically please go and get screened. Most people, we start at age 50, sometimes at 45. But if you have questions, if you're not sure, if you want to just talk about it, come see us, talk to your primary care doctor, and we'll help you get the most appropriate test for you. If you find something, a lot of the times we can fix it at the same time, and if we can't, we at least know what to do, and we will help you to get to the next test and next step.
And again, as with anything, early detection, go have your annual physical. You know, it's with breast cancer, get those mammograms, prostate cancer, you know, colorectal cancer. There, if you get that annual physical, get the proper test, talk about your genealogy, know the benchmarks of age when you should start. I mean, again, everything, early detection is key.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Well, what if we want to get our screening done like a good soldier? And Claudia Dunn Martinez is with UCLA Health. As I said, involved in our community here, good, nice footprint. A lot of great medical services available. Claudia, thank you for stopping by. Thank you for all the work you've done on coordinating this for us.
Thank you, Myles. No problem.
So tell us a little bit about UCLA Health. Tell us about that footprint I've mentioned. And then what if someone wants to get screening and utilize UCLA Health to do so?
Okay. Thanks. Well, most people, I think, by now realize that you don't have to go to Westwood to get this level of care. It's not at Ronald Reagan downtown. It's there, of course. It's always been there. It's the mothership. But and in reality, we now have over 180 community practices throughout Southern California. So no matter where you live, pretty much you can get the level of care or screening that you need. Drs. Quon and Dr. Issa happen to be in our working out of our practices here in Santa Clarita, which are located over on Turney Road, and their particular specialties on McBean near the Henry Mayo, on the Henry Mayo campus. And you can call to get an appointment if you'd like to get a screening. You can call 1-800-UCLA-MD1, and that will take you to our call center, which will help you get an appointment here in Santa Clarita, request Santa Clarita, request digestive diseases. That's where they're practicing out of. Or you can go to uclahealth.org/Santa Clarita, and that will take you to the webpage that will tell you about all of our doctors in Santa Clarita and the different specialties, pretty much soup to nuts we have, but with reference to this topic, digestive diseases is there. We have a very robust practice here, and I'm happy to do screenings here. They're done here in Santa Clarita.
Well, very cool. Well, thank you again for everything, you guys. Claudia, for coordinating this, Dr. Issa and Dr. Quon for coming out. A real quick reminder, folks, no on 13 if you're voting today. And also, please, if you'd like to participate in our Out of Darkness Walk coming up in April, please go to afsp.org/Santa Clarita, and you could donate, you could form a team, you could be a sponsor. We'd love to have you as a sponsor. Bringing suicide awareness and prevention and mental illness assistance, getting rid of that stigma. We always talk about taking care of ourselves physically, like we just did here today, but we also have to take care of ourselves mentally and do some whatever. You know, the word therapy is so frowned upon, but it's just talking to someone, folks. But again, we'd love to have you. The Out of Darkness Walk, it's on Saturday, April 25th. It's at College of the Canyons. Registration will be at 8 a.m. The walk starts at 9 a.m. We're out of there by noon. We would love to have you. So afsp.org/Santa Clarita. That does bring us to the end of our hour. And again, go to our podcast, spread the word, and we'd love you to give a listen. If you've missed any part of the show, again, go to the podcast. Dr. Issa, Dr. Quon, I appreciate your time. Interventional gastroenterologist. I say it right, UCLA Health. If you ever have any specific topics that you'd like us to grapple with here on Aging with Power, just shoot me an email at miles@agingwithpower.com or miles@comfortkeepers.com. And then I will do my best to get those subject matter experts onto the show and to empower us with the decisions that we need. We're sponsored by Comfort Keepers and Home Care. I'm Myles McNamara of Comfort Keepers. And folks, as we wander about, just remember, aging is not a disease. It's a journey. So do it with power.